I know we've got several people still trying to make their way in, but if you'll come on in and find a seat, there'll be plenty of time after our service today to visit with the family. So, Santa, there'll be plenty of time to continue to visit. I don't think they're going to run back to Nashville and Georgia real quick. So, there'll be plenty of time to visit with the family after we're over, more time to sign the guest book. You know, James Luna enjoyed a party. And if you had anything, any conversations with him after he turned 99 years old, he probably said to you, invited you to his 100th birthday party. And that's what we're doing today, is we're celebrating 100 years. So do me a favor as we start this morning, this afternoon. I want everybody to look to the right and look out the windows. And you probably see the pink azaleas over there in bloom. James Luna would have loved the flowers. He would have thought they were beautiful because he loved the flowers. So for those who don't know me, I'm Micah Brinkley. And a long relationship like so many of you had with Mr. Luna. And it's an honor for me to be here today to be a part of this service and honoring 100 years of life and the great life that he lived, our relationship with his family. And so I know on their behalf, I want to thank you for being here today. It's kind of hard when someone passes away months earlier and you have a service later on to wonder how many people will show up because life gets busy. And y'all have showed up well, and I know that is a great support to the family. The program you have, it may have changed a little bit due to some people couldn't be here today, and we made some changes there, but that's okay. We'll go with the flow. But thank you for being here with us today and honoring this gentleman's life. And at this point in time, David Franklin will come and say a few words and lead us in prayer to begin the service.
I too was wondering if there'd be a crowd. There's a crowd. I guess it's just the experiences I've had anytime you mention James Luna. Yeah, there's going to be a crowd. Everybody loved James. I think it was 2015 or 16 that James came to live at Kennington Point Retirement Center. Ross Road Church of Christ had been providing a Sunday morning service for residents there for a number of years. At the time, Tommy Tomlinson and I were rotating on the Sunday morning shift to do the services, and Rick Moore was leading our singing for us. Well, primarily appealing to our own fellowship with communion and singing, many residents from other faiths joined us in those services, and it was a great experience. When James arrived, something changed. Within 1 or 2 weeks, he made it a point to know every resident and every staff member's name, and he called them by their name. It was not long that everybody knew the guy, James, was in that wheelchair. That's who he was. His smile, his manner, his encouragement, his greetings just captured everyone. And so it was. After that, he was lovingly called the mayor of Kennington. And I understand that's the way it was every place he went. He became the mayor of fill in the blank. Retirement centers are very transient, as most of you may know. Residents come and go quite often, most of the time because of severe illness or death. And so their friends really, and the staff doesn't chronicle their departure. But amazing thing happened when James was getting ready to move to Nashville. And he'd only been there a year and a half, I think. 2 years, maybe? Kennington's staff hosted a going-away party for him. Filled the dining hall. Many of his friends from outside, including former students from all over Memphis and a former Memphis mayor, were there to bid him farewell. And even after moving to Nashville, I don't know who all he called on the phone. You want to raise your hand? Yeah. I know he would call my Judy several times a week. He called her sister up in Kentucky several times a week. And the standard fare was three verses of God is so good. And then he says, well, I got to go. Let's go to God in prayer. Holy Father in heaven, we gather before you, Lord, and we give you thanks for so many blessings, day by day, hour by hour. You have blessed us so abundantly with everything we need and even more. Thank you, Lord, for your Son who died on the cross for us. Thank you for your church that is his. Father, we gather together to celebrate the life that you gave to your servant, James Lunam. And through James, the light that he shined is the light of your love that he reflected brilliantly throughout his life here on earth. He shared with everyone he met, he was your faithful servant. Praising you was in his very being and soul. Loving God and loving everyone was not just a cliche for everyone in you, and we knew he was one of yours. Father, this is a prayer of thanksgiving. All of us who knew him, his family, his friends, his neighbors, and all the places he resided can give thanks to you for sending us the blessings of your servant, James Lunam. His legacy of encouragement remains. Father, now his faith is made sight and he's in your presence. May you continue to bless and comfort his family in the memory of this special man. Father, we name in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, we offer this prayer of thanksgiving. Amen.
Michael Seymour was supposed to be here. He could not be here because of illness. Richard Corum was supposed to be here. He could not be here either. I'm fourth or fifth string. I don't know what that is, but we're going to sing together, and this is not a solo, so will you sing out with me?
There's a beautiful place called heaven. It is hidden above the bright blue, where the good pilgrim ties are riven, live and love in eternity through. Above the bright blue, the beautiful blue, Jesus is waiting for me and for you. Heaven is there, not far from our side, beautiful city of light.
Goodbyes are never easy, regardless of why there's a goodbye. They carry with them a lot of emotions. They carry with them a lot of flashbacks at very special times. There was laughter from the fun times, smiles from the special times, tears from the hard times. And all these emotions surround each one of us with a swirling kaleidoscope of memories we will cherish and carry with us in the coming days. Today we're here to remember a very special man and our encounters with him through the many years that we were able to know him, James Edward Luna of Nashville, Tennessee, formerly of Memphis, was 99, 8 months, and a few days old when his faith became sight on December the 26th, 2023, when he passed away peacefully from this life. James was born 100 years ago today in 1924 in Walnut, Mississippi, to James and Lafayette and Myrtle Lucille Boyd Luna. He met Mary Shelley while teaching at Grand Junction High School after a brief courtship of 3 months. 3 months. They married on Valentine's Day in 1958. They were lovingly devoted to each other for 44 years before her passing. James's life was marked by service to God and others. He was a veteran. During World War II, he served in the Army Air Corps. Afterwards, he spent a career as a teacher, teaching in small communities in Mississippi and Tennessee, and finally retiring from the Memphis City Schools in 1984. He was a member of the Churches of Christ, and for many years served as an elder at Wooddale Church of Christ here in Memphis. He loved, and I mean he loved big, his family, friends, strangers, and most importantly, the Lord. He will be remembered for his faithfulness, his generosity, and his daily, I would say hourly, acts of kindness. He was preceded in death by his parents, his loving wife, his sister, Hazel Luna Graves, a niece, Jill Graves Clyburn, and beloved grandson, David Dutton. Surviving are his daughters, Mary Martha and her husband, Billy, Shelley and her husband, Neil, three grandchildren, Meredith, Olivia, and James, and their spouses, three great-grandsons, Gray Combs, Knox Combs, and newborn Luke, who surprised everybody by coming a few weeks early, many nieces and nephews and a host of friends. His grandchildren and great-grandchildren will always treasure their memories of Poppy. From the moment James Luna was born 100 years ago today, James Luna, I believe, was designed to be a man of God. I have no other way to describe this man than that, because that was his life. He was a man of godly strength. He was a man of godly character. James Luna was a survivor. He survived a lot of things in life. He survived the Great Depression. He survived war. He survived epidemics and a pandemic. He survived the wife of his beloved wife and what had to be the gut-wrenching death of his grandson, David. He survived losing his physical freedom to come and go as he wanted to. But with each survival, James Luna grew closer and stronger in his faith to God, because he understood and believed in God's will and knew that for whatever reason, God's will was leading him through these things to the place God wanted him to be and needed him to be in his life. He was a quiet servant leader. He listened to people, but he not only listened to people, he remembered what they told him. I was amazed at his memory so many times. He got to know people and was able to remember names and special things about them. His conversations were never superficial. They were always intentional. He was intentional when he listened to you and talked to you, gathering and remembering everything that you told him. I remember in the last days of his life, I was in Nashville with him and Mary Martha and Shelley, and we had him in the wheelchair coming out of the hallway, and one of the workers came out, and he had the hardest time recalling her name. And it frustrated him to no end that he could not recall her name. But what he did remember was that she was a twin. He could even remember the twin's name, but he couldn't remember her name, and I know it frustrated him that he couldn't do it. Anytime I was with him, if you were a part of his life, he remembered everything about you. The frame he had in his room there in at the lodges and at the meadows, we spent a lot of time looking at the frame. I mean, a lot of people go in and spend time sitting around the fireplace. We sat around looking at the frame of all the pictures that people had put on there. And every picture that scrolled through, he could tell you exactly what had happened, what party it was, who it was for, everyone that was in the picture, the ages of these people, and probably could tell what they had to eat. I don't know. But he exercised his brain, and that helped him continue to live a very vital life. He was also a person who showed appreciation. And you all know that. Anytime I went to see him, I could always expect a phone call later that day to thank me for coming to see him, to make sure I had made it home okay. He just appreciated people, and he appreciated people being a part of his life. James Lennon was a very humble man. He never bragged about his accomplishments in life, although I'm sure he could have. He never talked about himself and what all was going on in him and about his health issues and not being able to do what he wanted to do. He was always looking for somebody else. It was never about him. He was always talking about everyone else and how they were special in his life. He was a man who was trustworthy. His word was his honor, and he always kept his word. And he was a caring man. Some of you in this room were probably recipients of his care, of how he cooked for people, how he called people on the phone, how he made people feel special and important, and he remembered your special days. He knew when your birthdays were, even if your spouse didn't remember when it was. He knew when anniversaries were. He knew all those kinds of things. He just wanted to make sure people on their special days felt special and were remembered, and were cared for. He was extremely proud of his family. And I think I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. He thought y'all were the best. And he was proud of you. I don't know all of you that well, but I feel like I know you through all the conversations and all the stories of your lives. Every single visit we had involved this family and what was going on with them, and how they cared for him, and how they made him feel special. And I think that's one of the things that he passed down to them, to understand the importance of caring for others. And they were masterful at making sure that he was cared for. I knew about your birthdays. I knew about weddings. I knew about anniversaries, graduations, job changes, when you bought new cars, when you moved into new houses, and on and on and on. I could go with a list because he shared those things with me. And as I already mentioned, every time included the time around the skylight frame, getting to put pictures on there. And occasionally I got to put a few pictures on there of our family too. And he always loved the pictures. Family was his greatest blessing. And he remembered every single detail about his family. But most importantly, James Luna was a follower of Jesus Christ. When James was buried in baptism, he became a child of God. And he took that moment in life very, very serious. This wasn't just something to do because it was what everyone else was doing or because it was a socially acceptable thing to do at that point in time. He made that decision because he believed in his God, and he wanted that relationship, that deep relationship with the Father. James had two favorite Bible verses. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. In Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. You know by his life why those verses were important to him. They weren't just Bible verses. They were his life. And it's what he did every single day. He woke up in the morning trusting in God, and he went to bed every night trusting in God. And when you do things like that, you don't worry so much about life because you know God's going to take care of it. And God did. 2 Corinthians 3:1-3 says, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we may comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given to us. I believe James Luna understood that verse probably better than most anyone I know. It is easy to allow life's troubles to weigh us down to the point that we want to give up on life. It's an honorable thing to draw near to God for comfort in life and life's troubles, but then go out and search for others who are troubled and who need that same godly comfort in their lives. James Luna was a vessel. He was a vessel of God's love. And he didn't live his life every day soaking up God's love into his own body and reserving it just for him. He soaked it up into his lives and then allowed it to bleed out on everyone else for them to share in that same great love. So this was his life. It was never about him. It was always about being the hands and feet of God wherever and whenever he was needed. The family has shared some things with me to read for you, to you today. Some interesting tidbits you may not know about him. Just some memories. So allow me to read these to you. Mary Martha shared the following interesting tidbits about her daddy. A lady at the lodge told her one day that Daddy was the only person she had ever seen who could play four bingo cards and do word search at the same time. And I believe that. I've watched him do it. We witnessed this one, and I still get a little emotional about it every time I read it. Daddy loved to go back into memory care and sing, quote, scriptures and pray with the residents. They loved him. On one of our visits to the lodges in Nashville, we got there and we had lunch with him, and before we left, he was like, you've got to go with me. You've got to go with me. I'm like, where are we going? He was like, you'll see. So I got behind his wheelchair and our family in tow, and we walked the hallways to the lodge into the memory care unit. And we wheeled his wheelchair around to the front of the room, and all the residents were there dealing with memory issues and probably in all likelihood didn't remember his name. Didn't know who he was, but he started to sing. And he sang Jesus Loves Me. And he sang the Star Spangled Banner. He may have sung Jingle Bells, I don't really remember. But we sat there in amazement watching him do this. And these folks who had a difficult time remembering family members' names, who they were themselves, but they could remember every word to every song he was singing and sang along with him. And it was a treat for their day. And we sat there a little bit, I think, feeling convicted in our own lives. Here this gentleman was in his mid to late 90s when he could just be sitting in his room and being sad about life and life coming to an end soon, but he wasn't. He was going to another place, helping people, helping their day. And that was a special moment for our family we'll never forget. As I've already mentioned, he invited everyone he saw to his 100th birthday. He probably started inviting them when he was 95. But you were coming to his birthday party. Mary Martha says she knows of at least two people her daddy met during his years in assisted living that he played a significant role in bringing to Christ. I would probably venture to say it was way more than we know, but we know of those two. He was the goat of encouragement. And if you know what that means, I'm not calling him a goat, okay? He was the greatest of all time in encouragement. If he knew you, he probably knew everything about your family too. And it's always been alluded to. That's why they called him the mayor at the lodge. He was always working the room and getting to know people. He was genuinely interested, and you could be sure he prayed for you and yours often. She says, when I talk to Daddy on the phone, I cannot begin to estimate the number of times I was hung up on in mid-sentence. We've all been there. I guess I actually got the last laugh, she said, because I just dialed him right back. The first thing Daddy did every morning was pray and then call her cousin Cindy as she drove to work between 5:30 and 6. Then Shelley and I got a call. He had regular calls he made every day to friends and relatives. He kept all of our relatives in the loop about what might be happening in the family. His calls may have just been to chat, to sing, or to pray. He had a close friend, Brother Will Young, who he prayed and sang with every single night. Brother Will is now in hospice care and will soon go to be with his Lord. And we are very honored to have Brother Will's wife with us this afternoon. He wished he could have been here. And I know, as she says, he would want all of us to pray for Brother Will and where he is in his life. Anytime Daddy went to the hospital, Daddy would ask all of you, he'd ask for a list of people to notify so they all knew where he was and not to worry. Because if you tried to call him and he wasn't in his room, you began to wonder where he was. So he wanted everybody to know what was going on in his life. She says, Daddy would always tell me when he was worried, I don't know what to do. I don't know which way to turn. So I'm just giving it all to the Lord. What a great anthem for your life. And finally, she says, Daddy had many names. Mama and her side of our family called him Jimmy. Dad's side of our family called him James Edward. His nieces and nephews called him either Unc or Jimmy. His sister, who adored him, called him Brother. The grands called him Poppy. My favorite was always Daddy. And I will miss his phone calls and getting to see him most every day, but I know he's with the Lord and family and friends. And I'm sure the flowers are beautiful there. Shelley sent me these words. Daddy, what a blessing to call you my daddy. You had a heart as big as they come, always thinking of the other person. You would give the shirt off your back, a trait passed down from your parents. You were gifted with making others feel special, being certain to talk to any and everyone you met, whether it was taking a home-cooked meal to someone confined to home, putting out or taking in trash cans for the neighbors, giving a Coke to the sanitation workers, insisting guests eat something and not accepting no for an answer, or welcoming a newcomer to the retirement home, you were always ministering to others. One area you excelled in was calling everyone on the telephone, again a trait required from your mother. You had so many phone numbers memorized. The telephone was part of your ministry to others. There were early morning calls to several people on a daily basis. These calls were made for years. Those calls encouraged others, and you in turn were encouraged. Now those friends who loved you so much sometimes call March and me. I have no doubt you would live on through the telephone. You were so proud to have served in the Army Air Corps. You proudly wore your caps. How timely to be honored on Veterans Day at Fairview High School last November. That was a very special day. Thank you for serving our country. In 1968, you and Mama made the decision to move from Bolivar to Memphis, specifically so March and I could be educated in a Christian school. That sums it all up. The most important thing to both of you was God. Thank you, Daddy and Mama, for this most precious gift. You love Mama with all your heart, as she did you. What a whirlwind 3-month romance before getting married on Valentine's Day. Such a sweet story. You were each other's best friend, and nothing was sweeter than watching you take care of her in those final years. You loved her so well. You served many years as a teacher. You were one of the best. Your students loved you, stayed in touch with you, and visiting you. Daddy, that was simply amazing. That's a teacher who impacted his students' lives. You saw the whole person, not just the task of teaching a course. What I cherish most is that you chose to imitate God, the Father. You loved him so much. Your love was unconditional. Never for one second did I doubt your love for me. You stood by me in hard times and the best of times. You were always there for me and my family. You had much patience, most of the time. You helped care for the fatherless and the needy. You were passionate about helping children go to Harding on the scholarship you set up in David's memory. You were a big supporter of the children's home, making trips to Arkansas to visit. You always reached out to those who needed a friend. This was even evident when you were living in the retirement homes. You invited the newcomer, hesitant of his new home, to sit with you. You assisted those at the table who were unable to perform certain tasks. You made them feel special. You never hesitated to ask others to join you at worship. And because God chose to work through you and you accepted, there are more souls in heaven. You worshiped right up to the end of your life and even preached a mini sermon just days before passing. You sang right up to the end too. You found so much comfort in the hymns. God is so good was your theme song. Thank you for your legacy that you and Mama left for our family. You welcomed and embraced every new addition to your family, the spouses, children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Your 4 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren adored you. There are so many fond memories they cherish, and our precious newborn Luke will know you through all the stories we tell him. Thank you, Poppy and Mimi, for the priceless gift of living Christ before them. You blessed us with an incredible legacy of faith. Whether through encouraging others, serving our country, teaching, bringing others to the Lord, or caring for your family, you made a difference in so many lives. Thank you for sharing his love with others. I miss you, but I'm overjoyed you are in heaven. Shelley. And these words from Meredith, his granddaughter. Happy 100th birthday, Poppy. I will be singing your rendition of Happy Birthday from Atlanta. I can imagine the heavenly angels sound much more beautiful. It's a high honor to be your granddaughter. Proverbs 17:6 says, grandchildren are the crown to the aged. You spoke of David, myself, Olivia, and James as if we were the crown jewels of your life. You instilled a spirit of confidence rooted in Christ in each one of us. I have vivid memories, both as a child and an adult, that I treasure with you. Here are a few. Delivering Meals on Wheels together while absolutely avoiding left turns. Cutting our coupons for Captain D's and eating together. You always gave me the crispy pieces. Handing out Cokes on Curtis Street to anyone passing by. Watching our dear sons, Gray and Knox, bring a smile to your face and the contagious laughter that followed. Listening to records in the back of your house. Receiving at least a daily phone call that often ended with you abruptly needing to answer another call. I've never met anyone more popular than you, Poppy. You taught me to seek God's guidance in all areas of life, no matter the circumstance. You showed me how a husband should honor his wife, both in actions and words, by caring for Mimi even after her last breath on earth. I witnessed your selflessness time after time, even up until your final moments on this earth. The last words I heard you say were, I hate how hard this is for you all. Despite your own pain, you were thinking of your family. The legacy that you built on the firm foundation of God's promises will continue to bless generation upon generation upon generation. Psalm 112, 1 through 2 reads, "Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who delights greatly in his commands. His descendants will be mighty on earth. The generation of the upright will be blessed. My boys and I reap from the seeds you have sowed for many years ago. Poppy, I have a birthday gift for you. When I was born, you reached out to one of your former students who was serving as the mayor of the city of Memphis and had my birthday recognized as Meredith Shelley Thomas Day. In honor of your 100th birthday, Governor Bill Lee has hereby declared today, April 7th, 2024, as a day of recognition for James E. Luna in the state of Tennessee. Your service to our country, community, family, and most importantly, God, is met with gratitude and admiration. Poppy, we call you blessed. I love you, I love you, I love you, Meredith." You're probably gathered today. James Luna was a man of great faith. And that great faith came from his study of the scriptures, of pouring himself into the Word of God. And not only reading the words, but actually putting those words into action in this life. Because he knew that every moment of action drew him closer to God and strengthened his relationship with the Father. And I'm not diminishing the relationships with his wife and his children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and all of us in this room. But truth be told, the most important relationship James Luna had was with the Father. And he understood that when you get that relationship right, all the other ones will eventually work themselves out. Because you stay focused, laser focused, on who you are to serve. Sometimes when we go to funerals and celebrations of life and things like this, sometimes the people that stand in front of you, and I don't want to be crude when I say this, and I don't mean to be, but sometimes we find ourselves feeling like we have to preach somebody on. And what a blessing it is in this gathering today that we know we don't have to do that. James Luna left this earth assured. And he believed the scriptures when the scriptures say that we can know we have eternal life. James believed that. And he didn't fret about eternal life because he knew that was taken care of. All he needed to do was live life. But I do want to close today with some verses, several, that I think he would want shared with you today. As he has left this life and has left us here to go on without him. He would want us to know that God's word brings us comfort on this day. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." Also in the book of Matthew, Matthew 5, verse 4, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." Psalm 34, 18, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed." And Lamentations chapter 3, "The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh every morning. I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance, therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who depend on him, to those who search for him. So it is good to wait quietly for salvation from the Lord. For no one is abandoned by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he also shows compassion because of the greatness of his unfailing love, for he does not enjoy hurting people or causing them to sorrow. He would also want us to know that God's word reminds us today of his promises. John chapter 14, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If it were not so, would I have told you that I was going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am. Isaiah chapter 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Psalm 56:10-13. I praise God for what he has promised. Yes, I praise the Lord for what he has promised. I trust in God, so why should I be afraid? What can mere mortals do to me? I will fulfill my vows to you, O God, and will offer a sacrifice of thanks for your help. For you have rescued me from death. You have kept my feet from slipping. So now I can walk in your presence, O God, in your life-giving light. And finally, he would want us to know that God's word gives us hope today for a future. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, what I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that your physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye. When the last trumpet is blown, and when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever, and those who are living will be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, the scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin power. But thank God, he gives us victory over death and sin through our Lord Jesus Christ. I think James Luna would want you to know that today. Of what we find in God's word that helps us through these moments. In Job chapter 19, Job talks about seeing God for himself with his own eyes and how he was overwhelmed at that thought. James Luna is overwhelmed. And we love that for him, that he is overwhelmed at the sight of the Father. And Mary Martha and Shelley, as he's told all of us, the flowers are beautiful there. Let's pray together. Father, we gather here today in your presence, honoring the faithful life of one of your servants. Our dear family member and friend, James Luna. Father, we've said a lot about him today, and we're not telling you anything that you don't already know, because you formed him to be who he was and to live the life that he lived. And he committed that life to you and wanted to be your servant, yearned to be your servant, and did it well. Father, we thank you for the moments that we all were able to share with him. through his near 100 years on this earth. And all the ways that he touched us and all the memories that he burned into our hearts and our minds of time spent with him. And while we miss him dearly, we know, Father, that he is in awe of you. And he is where he worked to be his entire life, with you. But Father, I pray that you be with all of us as we continue on without him physically here in our presence. Help us to constantly recall the man he was, the things he did, the service to others, and most importantly, the dedication he had to you. And help us all work every single day to be like him. And help us all to understand that the only way that we have the opportunity to see him again is to live as he lived and to leave this life assured of an eternal home with you. Be with his family. Help them to have fond memories. Memories that make them laugh. Memories that make them cry. Memories that urge them to be more of who he was in their daily lives. And we know, Father, that his family will have struggles. We all have struggles. But help them to always be confident in the fact that Daddy and Poppy is watching over them. And his love for them, even while not on this earth, is still as strong as it ever was. And he is hopeful for them in their lives. And I ask the same thing for all of us in this room who aren't family but are friends. Help us to be more like James Luna, so that one day when it is our time to be called home to be with you, we too will be overwhelmed to be in your presence. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, David, and thank you, Micah, for those good words who remind us of a great man. And I couldn't help but think, as I was listening, to all the blessings he's been to other people, that this family has been a blessing to him. I've experienced that in the past few days, just as they made plans for this service. Because I've tried to help families with services like this for years. I don't think I've ever done one like this where it was after the fact, and I tried to warn them, you know, people might not come. You know, they said they want to have it on Sunday. I don't know if Sunday's a good time, and, you know, people might not. We wanted it 1 o'clock. I said, 1 o'clock's pretty early. I don't know if that would be a good time. So I was really trying to prepare you for not many people showing up. So before we sing God is So Good, we ought to think of the blessing this family has been to him over the years. He loved you. You loved him. And for all of you showing up, just coming, and that's saying to this family, we love you, and in just thinking about you. So there's a lot of love in this room, and I apologize for cutting it short so that we could get started, but we wouldn't have got started till 6 o'clock had we stayed out there and just enjoyed. So now you don't have to go anywhere. Let's sing God is So Good.
God is so good. Glory.
Thank you so much for taking time out of your Sunday to be with us today to celebrate this great man. The family is here if you didn't get to visit with them earlier, and with that, you are dismissed.